You have your Bibles, like where you turn with me. Romans, the 12th chapter. I want to take a golden text here. We're going to be reading some very familiar scripture. Hopefully the Lord will be able to use what is said this morning to help you in your life, inspire you as a Christian to be what God has called you to be.
Amen.
Romans chapter 12, verse 1. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Amen.
Amen.
We'll flip with me to the book of Isaiah, the 6th chapter, and we'll be reading a very familiar verse of scripture because Sister Amy just read it. Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. When I read that verse of scripture, I realize that things aren't as the Lord would have it in this world a lot of times. You don't have to look very far and you see that things are out of kilter. People are out of kilter. Just have to watch the news and you realize just how depraved that humanity is. I often mention articles that I see in the paper, but I don't want to do that this morning because it's always bad news. One way or another, the degradation of morality or society is placed on the front pages or the forefront of our minds day after day after day. And what I want you to know is that is not God's will.
Amen.
And so you might say, well, why does it happen? If God doesn't want it to be that way, then why does it happen? It's because of free will, moral agencies, and people choosing to do what is wrong rather than choosing to do what is right. This scripture in Romans that we'll take as a golden text says that we should present our bodies as a living sacrifice. It's not that we're no longer living, but it's that we allow Christ Jesus to live through us, and that is the hope of glory. Mm-hmm. And that we should not be conformed to this world, but that we should be transformed by the renewing of our minds. So I want you to be renewed in your mind this morning by the Word of God.
Yeah.
Amen? And I believe through the Scripture, through all that I've learned in the years of being a minister and being saved, that God desires to touch people. Amen?
Amen.
God has a message for humanity. God has a message for this world. You can't look very far in the Bible without seeing the theme that God wants to communicate with you. In Isaiah had a vision. The Bible says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon his throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Above it stood the seraphims, each one had 6 wings, and with twain he covered his face, and with twain he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly. And one cried to another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the posts of the door were moved at the voice of him that cried. And the house was filled with smoke, and then said, Woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then flew one of the seraphims unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from off the altar, and he laid it upon my mouth, and he said, Lo, this has touched thy lips, and thine iniquity is taken away, and thy sin is purged.
Amen.
Also I heard the voice of the Lord, saying, Whom shall I send? Who will go for us? Then said I, Here am I, send me.
Amen.
Amen. Turn with me, if you would, to Acts chapter 10. Acts chapter 10. I want to lay some good groundwork for what we'll be sharing through the Scripture. You know, looking at that vision in the book of Isaiah, if you were to dissect it as an English major, I imagine that there are a few subjects of the sentences, whether it's the Lord high and lifted up and what Isaiah saw. The subject of the first line is it was the year that King Uzziah died. And so you look and see what is the significance of that. Or you might look and you might look at heaven as the subject and how that the angels or the seraphims realize the holiness of God. Or you could look at the earth and question, well, if the earth is filled with His glory, why aren't things different? And there's a lot of subjects in that text, but I believe the overriding text is a message to us, and that message to us is a message from heaven. I believe that God has a way that He desires to touch His people that's life-changing. How about you? I believe that God wants to change your life for the better. I believe that God wants to save your soul, and He has given you free will, moral agency to choose what's right instead of what's wrong. Every one of us had that same right. Every one of us had that same ability. And the message has been heard. Sometimes we don't like to get along with what God's message is. Amen. We don't want to let go of what we have or what we perceive as a good time or what we perceive as a way of life. But God has a better way of life. God has a better plan for your life than what you could ever concoct. Whatever you could dream to be the best life that you could imagine, God's plan is better. It might not include all the frills that this world has to offer, but I'm going to tell you that if you'll present your bodies as a living sacrifice to God, He'll transform the way that you think. And then you'll understand that His plan is better than your plan. His plan of salvation is better than your plan of salvation. His plan for your life is better than the world's plan for your life. The world does not want you to succeed. It might throw at you the things that look like success, but when the holy God of all ages is sitting on the throne and you appear before Him, nothing of this world is going to last. Nothing of this world is going to matter. Only your understanding of Jesus Christ and your relationship with Him is going to stand on that day. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Peter was a man who at times past had been conflicted in his understanding of who Jesus was. But after the day of Pentecost in Acts the second chapter, Peter was a brand new man. Peter's life did not mimic what it was before. Before he had doubted the Lord. Before he had failed the Lord. Before he had denied the Lord. But after that the Holy Spirit fell on the day of Pentecost, Peter became a vessel of God, used by God for significant purpose. On the day of Pentecost, Peter preached an international message declaring that the baptism of the Holy Ghost had fallen like it did in Joel, or like it was prophesied about in Joel. And as you see, Peter was used by God in a different way to bring the message to even us, our type of people. When Jesus was here, He said He must first go to the lost of Israel, and He did. But the message of salvation was not just to the Jew. It was to the Gentile as well. So, as Peter journeyed, look in the 9th verse of the 10th chapter. It says, on the morrow, they went on their journey. They drew nigh to the city. And Peter went up on the rooftop to pray about the 6th hour. And he became very hungry and would have eaten. But while they made ready, he fell into a trance. He saw heaven open and a certain vessel descending unto him, as it had been a great sheet, knit at 4 corners and let down to the earth, wherein were all manner of 4-footed beasts of the earth, wild beasts and creeping things and fowls of the air. And there came a voice to him, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." But Peter said, "Not so, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean." And the voice spake unto him again a second time, "What God hath cleansed, that call not thou common."
Amen.
Let me repeat that. And he said it a second time, "What God hath cleansed, that call not thou common." Amen. And this was done thrice. And then the vessel was received up into heaven again. So one more time to be with the scripture. What God hath cleansed, that call not thou common. Let me put that into modern day verbiage. What God has cleaned up, don't call that normal. Don't call that normal. Don't call that anything other than what it is. And so what I want to attack today is what the world would put into your mind about you, about the church, about God's work, about God's message. You see, the world will pervert the message of Jesus Christ. The world will pervert the message of peace. The world will pervert what you're supposed to be as a human being. But God has a plan for your life. Amen. And it's a plan of good and not evil. It's a plan for life and not death. It's a plan of eternity. And it's a beautiful plan. Amen. One last scripture I would like to share with you today as a text. It comes from 2 Timothy, the second chapter. And I want you to see this as clearly as I'm seeing it this morning. I want to thank Amy for being obedient, for reading that scripture. I believe that it might even be good if we read it a third time. I want you to understand, if we see the Lord in His holiness, we'll understand that we are lost and undone without Him.
That's right.
Amen?
Amen.
But that's not the end of the story. God wants to reach down from heaven and He wants to purge your iniquities and take them away. He wants to cleanse your life from sin and He wants you to be a vessel sanctified that He can use to share His message. And it takes a heavenly touch to be able to share a heavenly message. Amen. Amen. But God's arm is not short concerning His promises. He's not slack concerning His promises. And some people say just because He waits to deliver justice, justice won't come. Well, I'm going to tell you, there's a day of reckoning that we all will face, and we'll need to have understand the message that has been spoken from heaven and delivered by His only Son. Somebody amen. Say amen.
Amen.
2 Timothy, as the gospel begins to roll, Paul is speaking to a younger pastor and helping him to understand the things that everybody doesn't understand. As a matter of fact, when we look at that first text, it says, "Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind." You need to watch what you think.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
You need to watch what you say.
Amen.
Amen.
The scripture wants us to have a clear vision of who Jesus is, of who God is, and what His message to the earth is. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
If I say that again, shoot me. This scripture begins at the 15th verse. It says, "Study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." Each one of these verses I could take an hour or more on to explain the depth that is nestled in here. And I could just ask you, how many of you study the word of God to see what manner of person that you ought to be? How many take with earnest heed the word of God as it is given to us? "But shun profane and vain babblings, for they will increase unto more ungodliness." If you think on bad things are going to come out of your mouth. And what that's going to do is going to make your way tougher than it is already. The Bible says the way of the transgressor is hard. And many are the thoughts in a man's mind and his heart. But we need to have that in line with what God would have us think. And so I would rather you be transformed by the Word of God this morning than conformed to what the world would have you be.
Amen.
Amen. So as you look at this word, it says, "But shun." What does that mean? It means get away from me with all that foolish talk. Get away from me with that profanity. Get away from me with that vain babbling. How many's ever met somebody that just runs off at the mouth? Amen. Just keeps on talking, even when they don't know what they're talking about. Have you ever been in a conversation and they get headlong deep into it, and then all of a sudden you say, hey, wait a minute. It's not even right. Okay? What you need to do is begin to separate yourself from people who don't know what they're talking about. People who are giving you advice about things in life. You know what? Facebook is not the where to find advice about the things in life. Amen? Now listen, you might find an encouraging scripture, have some friends that give you some encouraging scripture and a good, solid counsel, but I'm going to tell you that there are more people with unbiblical counsel on there than there are with biblical counsel. Brother Gary, he posted on his Facebook about it being funny how many people will get on there and say, I'm getting off of Facebook. Let me tell you something. Facebook ain't your problem. Now, I'm not saying that about somebody that's not on Facebook. All right. Amen. Woo! But shun profane and vain babblings, for they will increase unto more ungodliness. It says their word will eat as doth a canker. And it mentions a couple fellows here that are doing that type of stuff. It says, who concerning the truth they've erred, saying that the resurrection is already past, and overthrow the faith of some. Again, the depth of this scripture. If your faith can be overthrown by foolish and profane babblings, you need to take and examine what you're believing and the foundation that you have built upon and how you've built on it. Every man needs to take heed on how he builds on that firm foundation. And there's no other foundation that can be laid than that which is already laid, which is Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Amen? Amen. So as you look at this scripture, you realize that there are people out there whose motive, their MO, is to teach you things contrary to the Bible, and you'll end up in a place that you don't want to be. I don't want my faith overthrown. How about you?
No.
I want to hold on to that which I have believed unto the end. How about you?
Amen.
Amen. I'm determined to hold out to the end. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So it says, be careful to avoid these things. And it says, nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, that the Lord knoweth them that are His, and let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Let me put that in modern day English. If you're going to talk it, walk it.
Amen.
Amen. If not, shut up.
Woo.
Okay, now I said it again.
I
won't say shut up stupid because, you know, I wouldn't have you ignorant. I won't say that. These guys were overthrowing the faith of people who had started off in a good way. And so you look at these scriptures together and you realize that there's a message that comes from a holy God, and the first thing out of our mouths is we're not worthy. And truly, we are not worthy, but when God takes that coal off the altar, when He comes down with His Holy Spirit, when He touches your life in sanctifying fashion, something happens on the inside of you where you're not conformed to this world, but you're transformed because you think different. You're transformed because you begin to walk different. You talk different. And then you are different because God has done something in your life. And then when He does that something in your life, don't pull back to the weak and beggarly elements of who you used to be. You need to persist and pursue that which is called holiness in the sight of God.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You like to hear it. You don't like to do it. It says, in a great house there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but wood and earth, and some to honor and some to dishonor. That's actually talking about you. And so I have a question for you. Are you a vessel of honor, or are you a vessel of dishonor? What has God called you to be? God has called you to be a vessel of honor. How you possess your vessel is determined by how you think and what you say and what you do. It goes on to say, if any man therefore purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified, meet for the master's use, and prepared unto every good work. It goes on a little bit to say a couple more things. Flee also youthful lusts, but follow after righteousness, faith, charity, peace, with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart. It goes on to say some good advice. It says, but foolish and unlearned questions avoid, because they do gender strives. It says, the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men, apt to teach, patient in meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves. It goes on, and it's beautiful advice. Unfortunately, sometimes we struggle to see the beauty of the advice, because the God of this world has blinded the eyes of them that don't see. And so we don't depart from iniquity. We still name the name of Christ, but we don't depart from iniquity. Our mouths persist in vain babblings and profanity, and we claim the name of Christ. Sister Shelley, she has a little thing that she said when she hears someone cursing. She said, do you kiss your mother with that mouth? There is a topic, the cursing Christian. I hit a nerve Wednesday night in the Bible study because one of the teachings of our church is a wholesome tongue. A wholesome tongue. I don't want to focus on what's wrong and what is cursing, what is bad to say. You know what's bad to say. You've known it since you were a child. If when you were a child you get your mouth washed out for it, don't say it and claim to be a Christian. You say, well, maybe God will forgive me. Yeah, He might forgive you. Perhaps He might forgive you when the times of refreshing come. But I want to tell you, if you're going to be a representation of this church, of God's church, of the body of Christ, avoid profane and vain babblings. I'm going to tell you this, it might be a little harder to take. Quit talking about stuff that don't make a difference. And just going on and on and on and on and on. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Oh,
shoot me.
I don't want to have to beg for amen. So I get in the habit of saying that. You know, but I want to tell you, there's a way of life that's pleasing to God, and then there's a way of life that's not pleasing to God. And you know, we're saturated with grace, and I understand the grace of God is phenomenal. But what we do, and what I want to drive at here, is we take the grace of God and we trample it under our feet when He cleanses us from all unrighteousness, and then we turn around and say, well, I'm just a sinner. It's not going to make a difference how I live because Jesus has saved me. No, Jesus doesn't want to only be your Savior. He wants to be the Lord of your life. He's a holy God, and He expects you to do better. He expects more from you. I expect more from you. I expect more from myself, and that drives me from an inner depth to be transformed by the renewing of the way I think. And you know what? The devil's tried to slip in and try to tell me some of you aren't worth the time that it's taken to get you to a point where you need to be. And I'll tell him, shut up, stupid.
Amen.
God doesn't operate on His timing. God's a miracle-working God. And when God cleanses a person, we need to be careful of not dredging up their past and defining them about what they've done in the past or who they were in the past. It doesn't matter anymore. It doesn't matter anymore what they've done. That's why I had this testimony season showing you that this leadership, the leadership of this church, they've sinned as much as anybody in this building. But when God forgives a person and when He cleanses them, they're no longer common. They're used by God as vessels to declare a message of salvation and a message of holiness and a message of righteousness that will not be stopped by what this world has planned. I want you to understand there's a way that you can walk that's pleasing to God where you don't have to self-deprecate. Yes. It's popular now to look at yourself and say, well, I'm just a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people with unclean lips. Who am I that I should speak about Jesus? Nobody. You're nobody. But when Jesus shows up on the scene, our minds should be transformed by the Holy Spirit that leads and guides us to all truth. When Jesus shows up on the scene and washes your sins from scarlet to white as snow, then there's something different. And don't go back and say, I'm no different than anybody else. You are different. Jesus has made you different. We should walk in that salvation. It says, as you have received Him, so walk ye in Him. So if He's purged you and He saved you, then you need to walk in the dynamics of who Jesus made you to be. He didn't make you to be just a sinner. He made you to be saved by His grace.
Amen.
Amen. A vessel sanctified, good for Him to use, and you can do that. Shelby, is she with the kids? She's out and about. How much does Shelby cuss, Thomas? How long have you been with her, Thomas?
10 years.
Now, Shelby may not be a lot of things. But we were talking this week, and what the devil will tell you is you can't. You can't be any different. But you can.
Amen.
You can be a light in the darkness if there ever was a light in the darkness. If God ever touched anybody's lips, He can touch your lips. If God ever sanctified any vessel, He can sanctify you. And then when two or three of us get to working towards the same goal, it's a dynamic force in the Spirit. When we get on the same page as a church and as a people, look out for what God can do.
Amen.
Because when we mind the same things and we think the same things, and I'm not trying to draw you into some type of trap. I'm trying to set you free.
Amen.
You're in a trap. Get out of it. You're not what this world defines you to be.
Amen.
That's why it says to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Some of you think I can't do any different. You can. You can, because Jesus says you can. You can live different. Amen.
Amen.
There are people who have been unfaithful that can be transformed into faithfulness. Amen. There are people who have been profane who can now be wholesome. There are people who have been dirty and now can be clean through what the Lord has provided for us. Somebody.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. If there's ever been a message that has been etched upon my mind and burned in my heart, it's a message of sanctification. A message that is so needed in this world by the church people who say they know Jesus. If you say you know Jesus and then don't mind the things that He teaches us to mind, you do Him a disservice.
Right.
Words like trample His sacrifice under the soles of your feet is a biblical terminology for people who find salvation in Jesus Christ and then cannot find a way to live a Christian walk. There are words like a dog returning to its vomit or a pig to its wallow that's used for people who hear the word of the Lord and then refused to acknowledge that transformation is available. I don't stand up here to tell you that change is unavailable. I stand here as a witness to tell you that you can live your life differently than what this world tells you you can live it.
Amen.
A vision. We saw Jesus in all His glory, it would change your life.
Amen.
The heavens open, Him looking down and seeing you, and I know the first thought would be, woe is me. because all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But when Jesus reaches that hand down and you see the sacrifice and the complete vision of what He has planned for humanity, you reach up and you touch the hem of His garment, you touch that nail-scarred hand, and He cleanses you and surges through your life with power that's transformative, that's life-changing, that's soul-saving, that's enormously beautiful to the depths of your soul. When you see that and have a vision of that, you realize that God wants you to be different than everybody else.
Amen.
God wants you to be different. And when He says things like, take up your cross and follow Me, come after Me and I'll teach you what it means to be a fisher of men.
Amen.
There's purpose in that. There's purpose in what God has planned. You are part of that purpose. But the focus is not just you. It's to deliver a message of a holy God
Amen.
To a sinful people.
Amen.
And if we're no different, the message won't be heard. The Bible says if our gospel is hidden, it is hidden to those that are lost. So if we say we know Jesus and still are enamored by the glamour and glitz of iniquity, we do a disservice to the truth of God's Word. I would like for you to stand with me, if you will. I want God to be able to use you. Amen. I'd like for Brother Sean, if you would, to come to his instrument while he plays this morning. I want you to think of the vision that Isaiah saw and the message that was shared. I want you to think of the dream that Peter had and why it was shared. I want you to think of the words of the Apostle Paul to his loyal subject Timothy and why it was shared. If you look at the culmination of these scriptures, you'll see at the end of the journey, there's a message that needs to be preached. There are teachings that need to be taught. There are people that need to be reached, and God wants to use you to reach those people.
Amen.
But if you won't quit yourself, God can't use you like He wants to use you.
That's right.
But if you come to yourself and you awake to righteousness, there's a way of life that the Lord has for you that's purposeful to spread the message of a saving, loving, caring God. So this altar's open this morning. If anyone would like to come and bend a knee, seek the Lord while He may be found. Feel after Him, because your life can be different. Some of you have played around on the edge of Christianity and you try to have your cake and eat it too, and it doesn't work that way. Some of the things that God used to wink at, He's not winking at anymore. You're hearing a straight scoop about a holy God that wants to lead a holy people. I'd like for a few of our folks to gather in with these at the altar, and let's have a season of prayer. If you're not going to come down, I'd like for you just to begin to pray where you're at, that the Lord would have His way in your life and in these lives as we're surrendering to the Lord His will this morning. Just pray, God, I want Your will to be done in my life, in this church, in these lives that are surrendering before You now. Lord, I want Your will to be done. Would You pray with us this morning? Lord, we love You this morning. We thank You, Lord, for this beautiful day that we have to worship You in. Lord, we thank You for the Word, Lord. We thank You for Your Word that sanctifies and teaches us about Your ways. We ask You to be glorified in what's shared and what's said. Lord, touch our lips and touch our mouth that our message would be clear. That the trumpets that we sound, a certain tone, that the people would assemble themselves to your cause, would turn from evil and turn to you, glorify and bless you.